Yeah, just a minute. Start a minute.
Sorry, did you say, shall I start or?
Yeah, okay, good. So welcome everybody to the ArcScience seminar. And we are very happy to have today Manjunath Krishnapur from IISc. And he's going to talk about free convolution and related topics.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Amritanshu and others for inviting me to this seminar. Of course, I don't know much algebra, but this is a topic that Amritanshu asked me to talk about. So I'll just, so it's not original work. I'm just talking about something that I know a little bit about. So let me start with a question. Okay, so suppose you take, a random variable which takes two values, let's say -1 and 1. So X takes -1 and 1 with probability half, and Y is another random variable like that. So then what is the distribution of X plus Y? Okay. So everyone can figure that out. So it takes values -2, 0, 2 with probability 1/4, half and 1/4, right? So if they are independent, so these are also independent. So here I have a similar question. Suppose I take two matrices. So it has eigenvalues. So let's say it's eigenvalues +1 and -1. Okay. So half are -1. So this is a diagonal matrix. So if I take two matrices, okay, the question is not posed properly. So the question M2 is another matrix. With half eigenvalues equal to 1. And half of them are -1. So what are the eigenvalues of M1 plus M2? Okay, so what are the eigenvalues of M1 plus M2? This is a question of the kind many of you are very familiar with and know. Of course, there is no answer to that. It can be many things. So for example, if M is like this, +1, -1, +1, -1, if M2 is also diagonal, it depends on how you arrange it. It can be many different things. But what we ask here is a generic question. Because if you make M2 diagonal, basically M1 and M2 have the same eigenvectors. And it depends on how they arrange. If you arrange the plus ones with plus ones, then you get something. If you arrange the plus ones with minus ones, you get 0 eigenvalues only, etc. Many things can happen. But the question is, what if there is no relationship between eigenvectors? That is, somehow they should not be like this, the same eigenvectors. They should be somehow unrelated, okay? So for this, let me actually show you. Okay, so let me share this. So here is a mathematical code I have already written to save time. So this L is a diagonal matrix like that with plus ones and minus ones. Now I want two matrices, both having the same eigenvalue. So one of them I can take as L. The other one should have eigenvectors unrelated to this. So what do? I take L and conjugate it by some orthogonal matrix. So any matrix which has the same eigenvalues will be anyway orthogonal matrix conjugation of it. But the point is, to make it unrelated to L, what I do is I pick a random orthogonal matrix. That is what is being done here. This is a matrix chosen from the hard distribution on the orthogonal group. Okay, so if you don't know what that is, it is the most natural way to pick a random orthogonal matrix. So that way, the eigenvectors of this Q dot L dot transpose of Q will be completely in a generic position related to the eigenvalues of L. It is the most random compared to, so the mutual relation is completely random. So then I add them and then I take the eigenvalues of A. So what do you think will be the eigenvalues of this matrix A? Does anyone have a guess? Anyone who doesn't know the answer, does anyone have a guess? what should it be? Should it be minus one? I mean, so these are actually, I have taken minus one, one. So will it be minus two, zero, and two as before or something else? So here is the picture. So this is the histogram of the eigenvalues. So they are not minus two, zero, and one. They are everywhere between minus two and two. So they go all the way from minus two to two. Actually, they are more near minus two and two and less here. So what is this probability distribution? So everyone here should know it. So this is, so here I fit the, it looks like a probability density. This is called the arcsign density. Okay, so in arcsign seminar, you should know this. So this, if you add these two random matrices with plus minus one entries, what you get is arcsign distribution of eigenvalues. That is very strange. So what is the pattern here? It's not just limited to this, just to show the point, I have done something else here. So what I have done here is, in this case, here I added both matrices had eigenvalues plus minus one with equal number. Here, I have added L with a conjugation of M, where M has eigenvalues, three different values. I have taken 0, 1, 2, 3, and shifted it. So it's actually four different eigenvalues, minus half, minus 3 by 2, plus half plus 3/2, equal numbers of them. And I add the two and you do see some shape coming out here. If you, okay, this shape is a bit weird looking, but if you do with a larger number, you'll see there is a definite shape here. So what is the, what is happening and what is, can we say what it is? So that is the purpose of the talk, okay? So what is this operation which is doing this? So for this, we should understand what is going on here. So let me just recall a little bit about convolution. So this one, what we do here is called convolution. So let me just recall convolution in a few different ways. And then I will go to this other operation, which will give you this result. So ordinary convolution, what is it? So let's say we have mu and nu, two probability measures on the real line. Okay, so don't worry about technicalities of it. You can take them compactly supported if you want. I'm not worried too much about it. So what is the convolution of mu star nu? So let's say mu star nu is theta. This is the convolution. So what is the definition of convolution? So there are many different ways to view this. So some of them will be useful. So by definition, theta is a measure which gives probability to A, which is something like mu of A minus X, d nu of X. This integral over the real line, this is what it is. So if what it means, a simpler one is if mu and nu have density, and nu has density g, then theta has density h, which is given by h of x equal to f of x minus y, g of y dy. Okay, so that's what it means. That's one way of viewing it. That's the definition if you want. Another way of saying it is this: if x is a random variable with distribution mu, y is a random variable with distribution nu, and they are independent in the sense of probability. So I'll assume people may have heard of this at least. So then x plus y has distribution theta. So this is another way of saying what is convolution. So there are other ways of viewing it. So for example, you can take the Fourier transform of a measure mu is a function defined like this. Mu hat of t is the integral of e to the I t x d mu of x. Okay, that's the Fourier transform of a measure. It's well defined. I is square root minus one. So it's a bounded function. You can always integrate against a probability measure. So then the characterization of the convolution is that theta is that measure whose Fourier transform is the product of the Fourier transforms of mu and nu. Okay, So that Fourier transform also determines the distribution. So this is actually a characterization of convolution, that it is the that probability measure whose Fourier transform is the product. Well, of course, closely related, I can take the log of the Fourier transform and say, so let's say, log mu hat. Okay, mu hat is a complex valued function, but mu hat of 0 is 1. So mu hat of 0 is 1. So at least in a neighborhood of t, mu hat t will be in some disk near 0. So this is a well-defined thing. It's well-defined, at least near for t near 0. Because log mu hat, I mean, so this mu hat, when it is in a disk like this, as long as you don't go near 0, log is a well-defined as a, you can define it as a holomorphic function with log of 1 equal to 0. So in terms of this, we can write psi theta is psi mu plus psi nu. Of course, there is not much difference between 3 and 4. I just took log here, that's all. Okay, so there are yet other ways. You can, instead of taking this characteristic function, we can look at moments. So let's say mn mu is integral x to the n d mu of x. Then how is theta defined? It is the one whose moments, whose nth moment, this is called the nth moment. So n equals 0, 1, 2, etc. Theta is that measure whose nth moment is mn mu times mn nu, because the product it factors, and that's what you get. It's similar to this one where the Fourier transform factors. So there is yet more. So this mn, one of the things is this actually is related to 3 in a certain way. What is this 3? So if you formally expand this, sometimes it's more than formal, but let's say this, you have expanded it formally, then you get it to the n over n factorial, and then x to the n d mu of x, which is mn mu. Okay. So this is how this moments and characteristic function or the Fourier transform are related. Similarly, this is related to another thing. So this is the last one I will write about the convolution, which is about cumulants. So what are cumulants? They are exactly like this, but with psi. So we write psi mu, you expand in t. This starts at 1 because psi mu of 0 is 0 because you have taken log of 1. So it to the n times something, that something is called the cumulant. These are the cumulants of mu. This is the definition of cumulants. Okay. So the expansion of, you take the expansion of log of the Fourier transform, and the coefficients in the power series are the cumulants. So, but because log of the Fourier transform is additive, from that it will follow that you should have, I wrote something complete nonsense here. Nobody corrected me. So this is complete nonsense.
Yeah, I was sort of wondering.
Yeah, it could be the sum.
The mu hat, it is theta hat is mu hat into nu hat, and then you have to collect the powers. So when you do that, you get n choose k, mk mu, mk m n minus k nu. This is what you get. It's a formula, but in terms of cumulants, it's much easier. Psi theta is psi mu plus psi mu. So the characterization is simply that theta is the measure whose cumulants are the sum of the cumulants of mu and nu. for all n greater than or equal to 1. So the cumulants add. Okay, so these are many different ways to view the convolution. Some of these will be helpful in the way we will generalize it. Okay, so last thing I want to say here is that there is a relationship between moments and cumulants. This is the log of that. So what is the relationship between moments and cumulants? You see, psi mu is the log of mu hat, right? It's a very famously known relationship to combinatorics. When you take log of an exponential generating function, the coefficients are related to the coefficients in what way? So one can write the nth moment in terms of the first n cumulants and vice versa. So, and that relationship is this. The nth moment is actually a sum over all pi in Pn. What is Pn? Pn is the collection of set partitions of the set n. N means 1 to up to n. Okay. So what we get here is that for each partition, so a partition pi in Pn will be written as, it consists of blocks, pi 1, pi 2, up to some pi l. Okay. So it may have l blocks. These are disjoint sets whose union is 1 to n. So for every partition, what we do is we take the product over j equals 1 to however many parts of pi are there. So let's call it l of pi. And for each part, you just take the kappa with the number of elements in that part. Okay. So for each partition, so you count the number of elements here, pi 1 and number of elements in pi 2. You take the corresponding kappas and you take the product. Then this is the relation. This is how nth moment is written in terms of the first n cumulants. And you can also reverse this. The nth cumulant will be written in terms of the first n moments like this, minus 1 to the L of pi minus 1, L of pi minus 1 factorial times product exactly like here. M pi j mu. Okay, so this is how you recover the cumulants from moments. What is happening here is that this is a very general relation. This has nothing to do with moments and cumulants. When you have an exponential generating function and the log of the exponential generating function, even as formal series, then the coefficients are related like this with the lattice of set partitions. So the set partitions, this forms a lattice. Under refinement. So you say one partition is finer than the other, you get it by breaking the blocks of the first one to get blocks of the second one. So all the blocks of the second one are contained in one block of, in some block of the first one, like that. So that's a partially ordered set. In fact, it is a lattice. And what we have here is a Mobius inversion. So if you have this formula, this is the Mobius inversion of that one. Okay. So cumulants are not much used in probability anymore, but statisticians used to use it in early 1900s and late 1800s. So there are ways, because sometimes they are better than moments, in somewhat better behaved than moments. So one, I'll just give one example, and then if mu is the normal 0-1 distribution, which means it is the distribution with density, this one, then moments are 0 if n is odd, and if n is 2k, then it is the product of all odd numbers, 2k minus 1, 2k minus 3, up to 1. These are the moments of the normal. Reasonably nice, but cumulants are even easier to write. Kappa and mu is 1 if n equal to 2 and 0 otherwise. So it is an even simpler sequence than this. that it is just zero. So one of the way statisticians used to use it was to check if some data is normal. They used to compute the fourth cumulant and see how close it is to zero. And that was a reasonable measure of normality. Anyway, this is the normal convolution. What was there in the picture with the random matrix, with those matrices that we were adding, is some other operation. So there will be two measures, which, so in somehow here, the Bernoulli measure with itself gives this measure supported on 3 points. There, the Bernoulli measure with itself gives the arc sign measure. So there is some other binary operation on the space of probability measures, which is what free convolution is. Now let me define free convolution. Some of these will go there, and some of these are not so easy to carry over. So are there any, at any time if there are questions, please stop me and ask. Okay, so is it okay?
So, huh. Yeah, I came in a little late. I missed your preface about matrices, random matrices. So going forward, will I miss something or?
No, I mean, I will come back to that. So you will okay. get it back. So the point that I mentioned was that in many, so if I have, so maybe I will come back to that. But
maybe I have a question related to that.
Okay, so then so let me first... share it and show Raghavan also. So let me just, where is that? Go ahead.
So the first matrix was just a diagonal matrix with alternating plus ones and minus ones.
Yes.
The second was a random orthogonal matrix, right?
Yes. Q is a random orthogonal matrix. So the second matrix is QL Q transpose.
QL Q. The original matrix. Oh, okay. So that also has eigenvalues plus one, minus one, but the eigenspaces are in general random.
In some generic position. I could conjugate both sides, but there is no point. It's a redundancy. So it's enough that I conjugate. You can take Q1 LQ1 transpose and Q2 LQ2 transpose. That won't change anything.
In here, don't you want to take L prime rather than L? Not literally the same matrix, but the same distribution only?
No, it doesn't matter. Every matrix with the same eigenvalues is of this form for some orthogonal matrix.
Okay. So you mean even if we took, so this randomization takes care of it?
Yes. It is, for example, permutations are also included here. This is a purely half distributed orthogonal matrix. It goes over.
No, but not quite, right? Because the number of ones and number of minus ones does not change when you.
Right. No, I don't want it to change. I want half of them ones, half of them minus ones, which is. I want half of them ones and half of them minus ones, which is equivalent to Bernoulli distribution, putting mass half at plus one and minus one.
Okay. So the eigenvalues are not random, but the
eigenvalues are fixed. Yeah.
Eigenvalues is random with those eigenvalues.
So let me quickly explain to Raghavan. Yeah. What I did was here there is a matrix. So I take two matrices with eigenvalues, half of them equal to plus one, half of them equal to minus one. And the question is, what happens when I add these two matrices? If the eigenvectors are in generic position, which is what this Q conjugation achieves, then it turns out that the sum of the matrices, their eigenvalues are distributed, they will be all the way from between minus two and two, and the histogram will look like the arc sign distribution. Arc sign distribution is this density, 1 over pi square root 4 minus x squared. So this is the thing. So is that okay?
So just the point is that a priori you should have taken L prime, but you're saying it doesn't matter.
No, L is the L prime. Oh, okay. No. Well, okay. It doesn't. Yeah. It doesn't matter. I mean,
analogy with a convolution, there is an apparent dependence between the two terms here, but in practice, there isn't a dependence.
There isn't because this Q is fully randomizing.
Okay.
So okay, so let me just...
That's fine.
He's taking a block diagonal 2x2 matrix, identity 0, 0 minus identity, and just working with that for L and L prime. There is no randomness there. The only randomness is in Q.
See, Siddharth, it is as if I wrote X plus epsilon X, where epsilon is a random plus minus one. Although there looks like there is a dependence, there isn't.
Correct. That's what I said. So there is an apparent dependence, but in practice, no dependence. Fine.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so now so this all was the recap of convolution. Now I will say what is free convolution. Free convolution is something very analogous to this. It's a different binary operation. Okay, so I don't know whether it is a good idea to go to the white side so I can write on the side, but okay, let me write below. So let me write here. What is free convolution? So of these, many are, it's not, I mean, so this way, one is not a good way to generalize. Two is will come, but that I don't know if I will get to it. If I manage to do the analog of two, that will be free probability instead of just talking about free convolution. The easiest is to go to six. Okay, so I will do an analog of six. Okay, so what we have again is mu and nu are two probability measures on and then the moments are defined exactly as before. Okay, except I define the cumulants in a different way. I should have used a different symbol here. Unfortunately, I used that, but I will use this again. So now we use a different lattice, just like moments and cumulants are related this way. I will use a different lattice for this. It's a highly unmotivated definition, but it is the quickest way to for me to define free convolution. So let nc of n be the lattice of non-crossing partitions of the same set n. Okay, so what is the, now the condition is that it's non-crossing. So what do we mean? So again, n is the set 1, 2 up to n. And what is non-crossing? So again, a partition pi in ncn will have blocks. Except the what is the non-crossing condition? So let's take an example, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I write the blocks like this. So let's say I have pi is pictorially pi, let's say, consists of two blocks. One block is 1, 2, and 5, and the other is 3 and 4. So pictorially, you would write it like this. 1, 2, and 3, you write in one block by, well, sorry, 1, 2, and 5 are in one block. So I write this thing, and 3 and 4 are in another block. So this is non-crossing. It's okay. So if I take pi to be 1, 2, 4, and 3, 5, then it looks different. So 1, 2, and 4. Now, if I do this, there is no way to write it in a non-crossing way. Okay, so if you write a picture like this, so this is crossing. So what is it precisely? So it means that, so non-crossing means means there do not exist I less than j less than k less than l such that I and k belong to one block and j and l belong to a different block. Different block.
It's 12 o'clock.
Okay. If that such a thing does not, here you see 2, 4, if you take 2, 3, 4, 5, 2 and 4 belong to one block, 3 and 5 do not belong to, belong to a different block. So that is the condition. Non-crossing means there is no such four things, I, j, k, l, with I less than j less than k less than l, such that this happens. So then you say it's a non-crossing partition. So it is a reduced number of set partitions. It is also a lattice. So this forms a lattice also. So a lattice means there is maximum and minimum and this kind of stuff under refinement again. The partial order is again refinement. If you take a non-crossing partition and refine it, that is you break the blocks into smaller blocks, you will still remain the retain the non-crossing condition. If you join blocks, you may lose the, if you have the non-crossing condition, if you refine, it will retain the non-crossing. So it's a partial order and it's also a lattice. So what we do is define a new set of cumulants, not these kappas, a new set of cumulants, but using this lattice. Okay, so this is the definition of free convolution.
So just to clarify, I think the point is that the meet and join preserve the non-crossing condition, but it's...
Sorry, I missed one word. What did you say again?
Just to clarify, the non-crossing condition is preserved under meet and join, but not under refinement or...
Jumping.
It's not an ideal in the lattice of set partitions, but it's a sub-lattice.
I see. Okay. But if you refine, it will retain the non-crossing condition.
I don't think so. Like if you take the partition with one block, everything is a refinement of that. But of course, not everything.
No, for me, I was saying refinement is in the other direction, where you break the blocks into smaller blocks.
Again, the discrete partition is non-crossing and every partition... So either way...
Sorry. Yeah. Okay, what am I saying? You're right, completely.
So what you're saying is that the meet and join...
Two. Sorry. Yeah. So let me just... Yeah, and yes, you're right.
Right. But in any case, the non-crossing partitions do form a sublattice of...
Yes.
Yeah, I think that's the crucial point.
That's the correct thing. Yeah. So what I said was wrong. So it is a lattice with the and sublattice of the previous one.
And just to clarify what's going on now, so given two distributions, mu and nu, you take their cumulants, then do this operation on the cumulants, and then the free convolution would be the probability measure whose cumulants are these new k's. Is that the point?
So I didn't say. So one way of defining, so all, the point of my writing all these all could be taken as different ways of defining normal convolution. So if I take the number 6, what that is saying is that how do I define theta if I am given mu and nu? So it says that you take the cumulants of mu, add it to get another sequence of numbers and look for that measure whose cumulants these are. That is how we define convolution.
Another point I think one should make here is it's not exactly a sublattice. So what you can show is that if you take two non-crossing partitions and take their meet in the lattice of all set partitions, then that is non-crossing. And so that's fine, but it's not true that the join in the lattice of non-crossing partitions coincide with the join in all set partitions. You can find examples like that.
So the minimum one will be somewhere higher possibly.
So one needs to be a little more careful, but it is true that non-crossing partitions form a lattice as a sub-poset of the poset of all set partitions. I think that's the correct statement.
Right, I see. Yeah, so I think so the example you're saying is if we take something like this and let's say something like this, then I think the common refinement will be all 4 singletons or something like that, probably. Okay.
So I think Bishal in the comments has said it precisely. It's a subposet which is a lattice in its own right.
Okay. So what I want to do now is just to define free convolution, we will use similar formulas with the non-crossing. So define kappa and mu by this formula. Sum over all non-crossing partitions of the product I'm using the same kappa n, but these are called free cumulants. Okay, so these are called free cumulants, and I have not said what I mean. So this is the definition. This actually defines kappas. It's kind of easy to see, but maybe one easy way is to write the inversion formula. The way it is because what. All this, only when you take pi to be the entire thing, one single block, you have a kappa n on this side. All the others are lower kappa. So you can start defining kappa naught, there's no kappa 0, kappa 1, kappa 2, kappa 3, and so on inductively by looking at m1, m2, m3, and so on. But the inversion formula is using the Mobius function of this lattice, which is not minus 1 to the L of pi minus 1 times L pi minus 1 factorial, but a slightly different quantity. But that is what defines. So you take all pi in non-cursing partitions of n, minus 1 to the L of pi minus 1. Here you don't have L pi minus 1 factorial, but you have C of L pi minus 1, I think. Let me just check. Is it? Yeah, so C L pi minus 1 product M size of pi j mu. And this CK is the Ketalan number. So these C are Ketalan numbers, which is 1 over K plus 1, 2K choose K. Okay, so this is how you define kappa n for n greater than or equal to 1. So this is the definition of free cumulants. And then you have the definition of free convolution, which is like this. The free convolution of mu and nu is theta means kappa n theta is kappa n mu plus kappa n nu. Okay. So this is what is the definition for all n. In fact, it always exists. So if you take the sum of two cumulant sequences, free cumulant sequences, you will get another free cumulant sequence which actually corresponds to a theta. And it is called a free convolution. So actually, I should have said here, these things make sense only when all moments exist. Not every probability measure has all moments. So we are assuming that all moments exist. Okay, so let's work only with compactly supported. It's not necessary to restrict so much, but it's fine. For this talk, let's compactly supported probability measure. So then all moments are defined, etc. And this will be actually a cumulant sequence and give you this. This is the definition of free convolution. Okay. So maybe I can give examples. Now is a good time to give examples. So let's take three probability measures. So I will take, so the probability measure, I want to take three of them. One is the Bernoulli symmetric, which is putting mass half at 1 and half at minus 1. And then the arc sign, which also showed up, it is the measure with density 1 over pi square root 4 minus x square on minus 2, 2. That's the density of the arc sign. There is another important one that shows up, which is called a semicircle, which has a density which is square root of 4 minus x square over 2 pi, I think, on minus 2, 2, 2. So this one looks like this. We saw in the picture. This one looks like this. So this is the arc sign density, which blows up at the two endpoints. This vanishes at the two endpoints. So this is the probability measure. Then what are the moments and cumulates? Moments. If you take the moments of Bernoulli, it is easy. All these have 0 if n is odd and 1 if n is even. Whatever moment you take, it will be 0 or 1. In this case, again, it is 0 if n odd. Because all these are symmetric measures, the odd moments or cumulants will be 0. But the what are the moments of the arc sign? If you do the this, you will see that it is just
I don't know if we lost. I can't hear Manju.
I think we lost Arvind as well. So maybe power cut or something nice.
Maybe we lost IISC.
Well, no, IISc has no power cut. Oh, Arvind is frozen. Maybe just maths department. I'm at home.
Anyway, let's hope that he comes back. Yeah, we lost his. Yeah, this point about sub poset being a lattice at all is somewhat subtle, in fact.
A bit confused. Yeah, Amri, while we are waiting, can I make a suggestion? When you send around this announcement about the lecture, maybe you should alert people that you need to be registered on.
Actually, I would. I should have sent out the link in the email itself. It seems.
Can you hear me now? I mean.
Yeah. I think we lost you for a couple.
Yeah. So I don't know when I was lost. So maybe the sharing also has stopped. Or...
Yes, you need to share again.
Okay. Yeah. So I was giving examples of these things. So was I audible when I was saying these three measures?
Yes.
We lost you in the middle of ArcSine, but I think...
Okay. ArcSine has zero, you said, for odd, and that was where you froze.
Okay. So the even moments are just binomial coefficients. And for semicircle, the odd moments are zero, even moments are Catalan numbers. Okay. And what are the free cumulants? The free cumulants are given by... Okay, this is a little complicated. Let me just look up. So the free cumulants actually for the semicircle are the simplest. 1 if n is 2 and 0 if n not equal to 2.
Like the normal.
Yeah, it's exactly like the normal. For the normal, it's this sequence, but for the ordinary cumulants, not for free cumulants. For semicircle, it is this. So semicircle plays the role of normal in the free probability theory. For ArcSine, so these cumulants, let me just write down. So again, 0 when n is odd. So let me just write what happens. So it is minus 1 to the k minus 1 over k. 2k minus 2, choose k minus 1 if n is 2k. And for ArcSine, it is minus 1 to the k minus 1, 2 over k, 2k minus 2, choose k minus 1. If n is 2k. So these are calculations one can do. It's not too complicated. You have the formulas. You can do all these calculations. It's not that there are too many probability measures for which you can do calculations. There are very few, and these are some. But as a consequence of this, you see that so let's give these names tau, mu, sigma, let's say.
So those you see are that also shifted Catalan numbers with the sign.
This one, but with a sign, yeah.
Yeah, both.
So, right. Yes, that's right. But this one has a factor of 2. It makes a big difference in the probability distribution, actually. So you see, what you see is that kappa and tau plus kappa and tau is actually kappa and mu. This is just the double of this, 2 times that. So it is, if you add 2 of these, you get that. Which.
This is a proof of your first experiment.
Well, not a proof of that, but here is, there we saw a picture. Here is an operation which seems to give the same. Yeah. So tau, free convolution, tau by definition is mu because the free cumulants are. Yet another one, nice one, which you can see is that if you do kappa and sigma plus kappa and sigma, okay, and
I'm a bit lost here. So the operation on the cumulants here is the classical operation or
the addition is the, okay. So the moments are the same. When you give me a probability measure, there's a moment sequence defined in both the normal.
Okay, so you've taken the free cumulants. Yeah, you the corresponding that. Okay, okay. Sorry, I was a bit lost. Go ahead. Okay. Thank you.
So the how the free cumulant is defined in terms of the moments is different from how the ordinary cumulant is defined in terms of moments.
Yeah, I forgot.
But the rest of it is the same. I mean, the, how you define convolution is by addition of cumulants, but in this case, free.
Yeah.
So if you do kappa and sigma plus kappa and sigma, what do you get? You get, and let's say you get 2 if n equal to 2 and 0 otherwise. So this turns out to be just the cumulants of free cumulants of sigma scaled up by 2, scaled up by root 2. That is, it's a density on something like this is a measure on minus 4 to 4, scaled up by root 2, I think. So, okay, so what this means is that.
Is kappa in homogeneous of degree n, just like the nth moment?
Homogeneous in what?
I mean, if I scale the random variable by a constant alpha.
So what happens if you scale? Yeah. So you see that if you scale, you get 2 to the n here. And the sum of the block sizes is also, it's a good question. Maybe. So if you take 2 to the n, the block sizes are also summing to n. So if you take 2 to the mod pi j, then the identity remains. So it is exactly that. So because of that, cumulant is, so what this shows is this is analog of if x, y are iid normal 0, 1, then x plus y by root 2 has the same distribution as x. Means normal 0, 1. So this is the analog of that. So this is, and this is the unique such distribution. There is no other distribution such, there is normal 0 with other variances. That's also there. But let's say unique more or less, which satisfies this, because of which the central, this is what arises in the central limit theorem. This fixed point relation is the reason why this arises in the central limit theorem. So this is the analog of the normal distribution in free probability. So this is what I have done. Okay, so as I expected, it took way more time than I tend to go slow. Maybe if with slides, it would have been faster. So I have not described what is the free probability. I have only defined free convolution. What is free probability? It is as if I have defined convolution, but without any probability. So free convolution is one part of free probability. So now there are two possibilities. So I can take a vote on this. I mean, so I can tell the framework where this comes from, because this was a bit of an ad hoc definition, where this comes from, which is the free probability and free independence. The other option is I tell you, two situations where this arises. One is the random matrix. Now I can state it precisely what happens. Another is in this asymptotic representation theory. So I think I can do only one of these two. Any preference, Amitanshu, what I should do?
I'd go for the first choice if we are forced to choose. Yeah.
Okay. So the framework. So where does this come from? So this whole thing was the analog of 6. Okay. And of course, in terms of moments, what happens? So let me just write here. I did this, right? I mean, in the free side, we took this as the definition, more or less. We just defined cumulants differently. Can I write in terms of moments? In other words, the moments of the free convolution, can they be written in terms of the individual moments? Yes.
One second. So we have a long tradition in our seminars of allowing talks to go into a later week. So,
okay.
We would like to keep that possibility open of a second talk. So you could keep that in mind.
I can, but if there is interest in listening, what happens is that I would then tell the appearance, how it appears in asymptotic representation theory and in random matrix theory.
Yeah, I think that would be very nice. So
okay, keep that. Okay, so then I will just define the framework. So maybe at some later time, I or someone else can do it actually. So, okay. So let me just do that then. So in terms of moments, you can write definitely, because we have what is the theta cumulants are related to the cumulants of mu and nu, right? I mean, definition of, well, where is it? Kappa and theta is this. So in principle, you can go to the moments and write everything in terms of moments, but it's just complicated. I don't want to write it. Now, what about these two analogs of the transforms? Yes, there is actually two things. So there are integral transforms, which we can write analogous to this. So I will just write the names here. The analog of the Fourier transform would be the Stieltjes transform, but it won't have a product form. It is very complicated how it transforms, but the analog of the log Stieltjes transform is something called the R transform, which I may come to later. Okay, maybe I will even define. So the R transform is something nice. So the R transform of a measure is something that will be additive. So you know what it should be then. Okay, so the R transform. So let me define here. So for a measure mu, R transform of the measure is just defined as kappa n mu over z to the n plus 1, z to the n. Sorry. I think it is just z to the n. Kappa n mu z to the n. N equals 1 through infinity. So then it is clear that for the free convolution, the R transform should add. Because by definition, the coefficients are the free cumulants. So they add, so the R transforms will add. What you may want to ask is this well-defined, is it a formal series or an actual series? This is an actual series which converges in the neighborhood of zero. And these are analytic functions which are helpful in doing these calculations. So that is the analog of that. Now, the analog of this is, I don't even know. I have never seen a formula. It is way too complicated. If you give
me... I was hoping for a better explanation of the R transform as in, the cumulants in the classical case are just the log of the exponential. So there is a similar functional, the log of the,
Right. So how it is related to Stieltjes transform is how I can say it. I mean, so this is just that this looks, this has no content. I have just defined it like this. So then R is additive. But how is it related to the rest of it?
And why do non-crossing partitions appear in that?
Okay, so I will define free independence. So here, of all the ones, this is the part I'm going to do now. What is the analog of summing random variables? Okay, so everything else, I mean, so then it will be at least a little clear maybe. Okay, what is the notion of free probability? Okay, so this is where I bring. Okay. So what we start with in free probability is, so we start with two things. A is a, it's a unital star algebra. Okay. So it's an algebra, means there is a, it's a vector space over C with multiplication. So the multiplication is not commutative, but associative and distributes over addition and all that. The star means there is an operation A star, which is idempotent. So, It's A star star is A. Okay. So that's what and unital means one, which is a multiplicative identity. So, and then what, there are two ingredients. One is this unital star algebra and another is what is called a state. So it is a state. So what it is a, it's a linear functional. It sends the identity to multiplicative identity to one and it is positive. What is positive? Any element of the form A star A will have non-negative phi. So this is called a non-commutative expectation. Okay, it is like expectation. Expectation, what it does is A should be thought of as the algebra of random variables. If you are familiar with probability, A is the analog of random variables. For random variables, there is defined an expectation, which is a complex number. And the random variable to expectation is a linear. Its expectation is linear. The constant random variable 1 has expectation 1. And non-negative random variables have non-negative expectation. These are the analogs of that, except the whole algebra is non-commutative. Okay. So one example, trivial example, if A is L infinity of a probability measure, and phi is the integral A d mu. This is one example, gives the standard probability space, standard probability. But that's not the interesting part. So that's the standard probability. So this is the setting of non-commutative probability space, A and Fi. But
can I take A to be a matrix valued random variable and Phi to be expectation of trace?
Right, you can take, yes. So for example,
normalized trace.
Yeah, so there are, what are other examples? So one example is like you did, so you can take the matrix valued random variables and trace, expected trace, normalized expected trace would be one possibility. So you take matrix n by n matrix valued random variables on some probability space. And what is the state? What is the non-commutative expectation? You should take the trace of your random matrix, divide it by n, and then take expectation. That is an example of a non-commutative probability space. But maybe you can take, this is another example, you can take a group algebra. Of G, so G is some group. You can take it discrete, but for the moment I'm saying, so this is just the set of all finite linear combinations of this form, let's say finite sums. Then all you do is phi of any element in the group algebra, you define to be C of the identity. So for the group algebra, you define phi of A to be the coefficient of the identity. That is an example of a non-commutative probability space.
So this require no positive elements or something here?
So what is star here? Star is, if this is A,
are the inverses?
Yeah. So you take CG conjugate and G inverse. So this is the conjugate, and positive elements means A star A. You can take it.
Then it's satisfied. Then it's satisfied, right?
Then it is. You get it. You will get it. Yeah. So because you will get sum of the CG mod CG square. So,
exactly.
Yeah. So this is a good example of a non-commutative probability space. The key notion is of free independence. That is, this was there for a while, but the free independence is the non-trivial notion. By the way, I'm already at 2029. What should I do, Amitanshu? So should I finish this?
It's okay. I think we can go a little over time.
Okay, so I will try to finish in 5 minutes. Okay, so free independence. What is free independence? So let's say A and B are elements of this non-commutative probability space. We say A and B are freely independent. If the following condition happens, first I have to introduce some elements. So let's define two subalgebras. This is the algebra generated by A, and this is the algebra generated by B. Okay. It depends on whether you want to say just freely independent or star freely independent, but okay, let me just define freely independent like this. So A1 and A2 are the algebras generated by this. We have phi of A1, B1, A2, B2, any product like this is zero if AI are coming from the first algebra bi are coming from the second algebra, and they have zero means, which means phi of ai is zero and phi of bi is zero. It's a very indirect definition. One way of defining the underlying motivation is this. One way of defining two random variables being independent is to say that expectation of x to the k times y to the l is the product of expectation y to the x to the k with expectation y to the l. So this is like that, but because of non-commutativity, it is way more complicated. So the way Voiculescu defined, Voiculescu was the founder of free probability. And so if you take two algebras, actually I started with two elements, but you can take any two algebra, subalgebras of this A, okay? You take any two subalgebras of A, you take mean zero elements from these two subalgebras, any number of them.
It's not needed that the subalgebras are commutative?
No, no, that's not required. Okay. That's not required.
So yeah. In this case, they are, right? I mean,
in this case, they are. But yes, in this case, they are. That's why maybe you can define. So I didn't do it that way. You can take any two subalgebras of this A and define their independence exactly like this, just that A1 and A2 are whatever they are. Okay.
Okay.
I mean, A1, A2 are two subalgebras, but the elements you take should have zero mean. And you take an alternating product, A1, B1, A2, B2, AK, BK. It can end with AK or BK. It may end with AK, that's also okay. That also should be zero. So this is the condition of free independence. Okay, it looks not very obvious why, I mean, to us, somehow this is a good definition, very good definition. After this definition, then everything goes along very analogous to probability. There were many different non-commutative probability things. So, but this one, this way of independence is something that goes, the analogy goes really far. I mean, it is very analogous to probability.
So, in what sense this is called free?
So one example, okay, so it's a good question. Why free and what is this? So an example is the following. So let G1, G2 be two groups. And you take G to be the free product of G1 and G2. Okay, so let's say A is the group algebra of G, and let's say A1 is the group algebra of G1, A2 is the group algebra of G2. That means these have only finite linear combinations of G1, these have finite linear combinations of G2. Then here we have the phi, right? I mean, the phi is defined exactly like this. Phi of any element will be the coefficient of identity. So the statement is AG1 and AG2 are freely independent.
Freely independent in what?
Inside this A. Freely independent in A phi. So why is that? I mean, so AG1 consists of elements like this. So what are we supposed to do? So let's take A1 to be some linear combination of CG, G with G coming only from G1, right? And then B1 is some CG, G, G coming from G2, some other, okay, some C dash G and so on. And A2 will be again from G1 and so on. Suppose you take a product, alternating product like this, how can you get an identity element, right? When you take a product of these things, what you get is when you expand it, here, all these have mean zero, okay? So these do not contain identity in G1 or G2. So if you look at the independence, phi of ai have to be zero, phi of bi have to be zero. So all these are not identity, okay? So non-identity elements. Now, when you take product and expand, you will get some non-identity element of G1 times a non-identity element of G2 times a non-identity element of G1 and so on. That will never be identity. That's the definition of free product. Therefore, you will never get identity in this.
So the group property, is that important, or can we work with semi-groups equally well?
Okay, I don't know. Well, at the moment, I think perhaps semi-group will work, but if you want star operation and all that, probably you need group. Here, I just defined freely independent. I didn't define star operation didn't come into this, but maybe then semi-group is okay. I don't know. Perhaps that is okay. I don't know.
So if you have an element of A1, all powers of that element should have phi zero.
No. Only phi of AI has to be zero.
No, but if I take all the BIs to be one in this product.
No, they have to be taken to be have mean zero.
Okay.
Why it is very important that these things have to have mean zero, then the product will have mean zero. That's what the statement is.
Okay.
That's why in each of these, the identity doesn't appear. And since they come alternatingly, and this is a free product, you cannot make the product. No identity will come when you expand this products.
So mean means the coefficient of the identity, not
yeah. So when you
the average of the
So this is the
for the eliminated case, we'll get back again the independence, right? Normal independence in
program. No, normal independence is not a special case of free independence. It is almost never because this requires, for example, if A and B have mean zero.
Okay.
Then phi of AB, AB should be zero. If you transfer it to normal random variables, you will be saying expectation XY, XY is zero. But if they commute, this is almost never true.
Yeah.
And in except in very degenerate situations. So normal free independence does not contain usual independence as a special case. It is a different thing. Okay, so I should end here just since I just want to just say that what does this have to do with free convolution? I didn't say that. Okay, maybe I should just stop. So the point is that maybe I'll take 1 minute and just say it. If A is in A and A star is equal to A, okay, if it's self-adjoint, then phi of A to the n, one can check n greater than equal to zero is a positive definite sequence. Okay, this is a state, but this is a commutative one. So you can check the positive definiteness holds, which implies that there exists a measure, probability measure on R such that phi of A to the n is actually the moment sequence of that probability measure. Okay, so there exists a probability measure, and under some conditions you can say it's a unique probability measure. So we call, then we can say mu is the distribution. Mu is called the distribution of A. It's only for self-adjoint elements that there is the notion of distribution by equating the moments, non-commutative moments, with moments of a measure. Okay, this I mentioned just to say that then the fact is what is it I want to say? If A and B are free self-adjoint, and let's say A has the distribution mu, B has the distribution nu, in the following sense that the moments of A are given with moments of mu, are then the moments of A plus B agree with that of what we defined as free convolution.
What does it mean to say A and B are free? I forgot.
That is the algebras generated by A and B are free in this sense. Freely independent. Freely independent.
Okay.
Okay, actually, yeah. So freely independent, and both of them are self-adjoint. Then we can associate to them measures. And then the addition of these random, freely independent random variables corresponds to free convolution. That's how it links with the previous things that I said.
In particular, you don't need the whole structure of the ambient algebra to get the get these moments of A plus B.
No, if you know they are freely independent from the moments of A and moments of B, you can determine the moments of A plus B. That is going back to this ad hoc definition of a free convolution in terms of the moments of the individuals, or equivalently cumulants of the individuals. We define the free convolution as kappa and theta as kappa and mu plus kappa and mu. So if you know the moments, you can write down the moments of the free convolution. Now we are giving a context where it came. It comes, it is the context analogous to point number two here, that the convolution is the distribution of the sum of independent random variables. Similarly, here free convolution is the distribution of the sum of freely independent random variables. Okay, I think I will stop here, but any questions I'll take, but maybe this is a place to stop, but I didn't of course link back to, so sorry about that, but maybe another time. How random matrix, so in some vague way you see random matrices are somehow, we are adding random matrices and here there is some addition. So somehow adding random matrices and adding non-commutative freely independent random variables is somehow, there is a link between the two. That's all we are saying.
So that is the example where A is the algebra of matrix valued
yes. variables. Right. Yes, exactly. And we have, the statement is that you have a sequence of random matrices and they are asymptotically freely independent, meaning that condition, if you take that particular n by n thing that you mentioned, non-commutative probability space with n by n random matrices with 1 over n expected norm, expected trace, then you don't get exact free independence, but as n goes to infinity, you get this, I mean, these things will converge to zero. There is a parameter n, so that's what happens. It's only asymptotically free.
So given two probability measures mu and nu on R, is there a kind of minimal or natural choice of A, you know, the your A, which in which you can embed a natural A1 and A2.
Yeah, that's it's a good question. Minimal, I don't know. There is something that Voiculescu calls canonical. He constructed on some shift space. I mean, there is a Fock space on which he constructs. But let me just answer a related question. One example is if you just take Z mod 2, if you want to do this one, so you take Z mod 2, this is the group and the corresponding group algebra, which is in this case very simple. It is alpha times, so let's call these elements as 0 and 1. So it is alpha times 0 plus beta times 1, where alpha beta are complex. Right, so this is the group algebra, and phi of alpha 0 plus beta 1 is alpha by definition. Here, if you take 1 itself, 1 belongs to the algebra, the distribution of 1 is the Bernoulli distribution. If you see, because what is phi of 1 to be, phi of 1 is 0. Phi of 1 plus 1 is 0, is 1, because that's identity and so on. The odd ones are 0 and the even ones are 1. So this is the Bernoulli distribution. So this is a minimal example for this random variable. That's why I mentioned this. But if you want a general measure, this is for Bernoulli. It's a discrete measure. So I could do it on such a small space. But if you give me something more complicated, then you have to take a larger space on which you can find. So for example, here what you can do is you can take the free product of two of these copies, then you get a big space, Z2 star Z2, that is a big space. And there you can take the sum of these two elements. So the one, the two copies of G will give you Bernoulli random variables. They will be freely independent. Their sum, you can check, will give you, that's a good exercise actually, if somebody wants to do it. What I'm saying is you take two copies of Z mod 2, you get two Bernoulli random variables, and I already said they're freely independent in the free product. You calculate the distribution of the sum. You should get the arcsine distribution. So that is an example. But for the general one, I will not describe now. You need to construct some Fock space on which you can construct these random variables with this. Yeah.
I guess you could do something similar for a general finite.
Yes.
Finite.
Then it will. You probably can do with the group construction. Finite group construction, you probably can do it. So one of the things very related to the question is that, I mean, you have to show that there exists really independent random variables. Probability starts with this theorem. Probability theory, the first theorem is that you can construct independent random variables with given distribution. So such a theorem has to be established here. So if I, is that possible? And for that one needs these constructions of what called Fox spaces and so on.
So this free independence is not the generalization of independence in classical probability. So is there any, I mean, importance of free independence in classical probability?
Well, there is no, strictly speaking, no, but there are two things. One is, there are two things, its relationship to probability is two things. One is analogy. The other is via random matrices.
Okay.
So large random matrices, which are independent in the classical probability sense, tend to be freely independent in the non-commutative sense. So this is the connection. This is the connection. And this is the analogy part.
I see. And this is called free because of this group, free product of two good examples.
Exactly.
Right?
That is where the word free comes from. Because this is the canonical construction of freely independent things. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
And one more, I had a question. So, you know, Nikhil Srivastav, Adam Marcus, Dan Spielman, they worked on I think they call it finite free convolutions of polynomials or something like that. Is right, that in any way related to this?
It is related. I don't know it well, but it is a very interesting one. Maybe if there is another talk at some later time, maybe I will also learn a bit about it and say there.
Aha.
So okay. The thing is, there the question is what happens at finite level? So what we were talking about is the n going to infinity case, that in many times, I mean, for example, we added two projections or two matrices, right? So there you want to do it at finite n level to say something about the spectrum, not with n going to infinity. This is somehow the point, I think, but I don't know that well. So I don't know.
Okay.
Hello, sir.
Huh? Yes.
Hello. Yeah. So this all they started for to understand this LF factors, right? Interpolating.
There is a operator theory motivation for Wojtylewski. I don't know it that well. Yes, but
okay. Yeah. So what are the other places? Actually, I little bit know about that LFs actually. But uh-huh. What are the other places that is interested?
Yeah, at least I learned a little bit. I understood it once, or at least I forgot it equal number of times as I learned it, what this operator business is. But there is this about factors. So I don't, but from what I understand, it didn't actually solve the problems that Wojtylewski wanted to solve, I think. So yes, I don't know what
it didn't solve.
Yeah, what it did for the operator thing, I cannot say. But a lot of, what shall I say? Many, so I don't know what it does for operator theory, really. I mean, so
actually, it solves some important problems, actually, not that free group problem in operator algebra. Using Wojtylewski, some Kartan sub algebra problem has been solved, actually, which was open for a long time.
I see. Okay.
Also, in that way, in planar algebra, we have some scenario. Uh-huh. We are attaching the planar algebra. If we start with a subfactor with some condition, there is a planar algebra way, and there the reverse way actually people studied, and our professor Vijay Kudiyala has done some work in that area. Yeah. So I know about little bit of that. What are other places where it can be used apart from operator algebras?
I don't know. I mean, this analogy with random matrix, the random matrix connection is the one I know best, and very closely related to is this asymptotic representation theory where it shows up. So, so for example, I don't want to start on that now, but so I don't know. What to say about that? Yeah, where else it comes?
Let me make it precise. If you continue this talk in a future level, in what direction it will go?
Well, next, if I were to continue, I have done this in my random matrix classes. So, what I would tell is about a little more about free independence, maybe, and then explain the how this free convolution, for example, and not only free convolution, some other operations that are natural in this free probability setting arise okay. in random matrices or in this asymptotic representation theory. Right.
Okay,
so, yeah.
Can you tell about asymptotic representation? What is that?
So, let Jay Kumar. I think I would like to point out that Manju has given a whole series of lectures on random matrix theory. And these are recorded and available. I think the notes are also available from his website.
My notes are there on my website. I don't know what was there in those lectures, though.
Recording maybe not. Yeah, but you have very nice notes. In the notes, somehow you mentioned this bit about you know, the relation with cubulads as something that is in the to-do.
Actually, it may not be fully updated. The one on my website, I should check. But the best place to read about the combinatorial thing is actually, I didn't even mention, actually. I mentioned only Voiculescu.
Roland
Spikers, I mean, he was the one who developed all the combinatorial side of it. So he has many lecture notes here on his survey talks and I mean corresponding notes on his website. They are actually very nicely written, very, very nicely written. So you can get most of the combinatorial picture there. And there's a book by Nika and Spiker. Of course, there's a lot of overlap in all these things. Nika and Spiker is a whole book, so it covers everything. It's more exhaustive. My various survey notes on his website, I'll cover aspects of it. Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Not so much the asymptotic representation theory part. Is not there. That you have to read some papers
I think your lecture notes are good for that, right?
Mine don't have it, right? Or do I have? No, I don't think so.
Oh, no, that's a random matrix.
So the analog of what I started with, the problem with what I started with is if you take two square permutation, square tableau, if this is lambda, and you take the corresponding tensor product of those representations, how does it decompose into irreducible representations? Turns out that most of the irreducible representations are close to this triangular shape of size 2n. So this is the exact analog of what I started with, where that you take Bernoulli and you get Arcsine. This is the exact analog of that. So this is the kind of result that comes in asymptotic representation theory. It's mainly due to Bian and relating to older works of Kerov and others.
Okay, sir.
I have a few questions. First question is, can you go to the definition of free convolution?
Free convolution, yeah.
Yeah. So here what you've done is you've taken, instead of taking the lattice of partitions with refinement as your order, you've taken the a smaller lattice, which is the we've had this discussion before. So you've taken non-crossing set partitions, and then you've taken the Mobius inversion there, and then you've obtained this formula for can you, instead of working with non-crossing set partitions, I'm curious if you can take any lattice on some subset of set partitions and work with that.
It's a very good question. Actually, I cannot answer you fully, but there is an old paper. I mean, for some reason, I was discussing with Arvind and we were looking at this, but I have not yet understood. But in an old paper of Spiker and I forget the other person. Okay, so what they studied was, instead of looking at, let's look at partitions, right? So all set partitions. So, and then you try to define this type of cumulants. Let me just say in words. So what happens in the normal convolution? We give weight 1 to all the partitions. Okay. You can look at this as giving weight, give this formula as giving weight 1 to non-crossing partitions and 0 to cause any partition which is not non-causing. So they were basically looking at what functions can I put on the space of partitions, which will give rise to some reasonable theory. Okay, so you may want to put weight one on non. So for example, one thing you could do is you can give a weight of a partition as q to the number of non-causing, number of causings. So the weight is one, if ever q is some number less than one, let's say. So then you are penalizing causings, but not that you are just throwing them out. When q is close to zero, this is like taking only non-causing partitions. But when q is close to one, it's like all partitions. So this is one example where it is okay. But there is a paper where they study and that question remains open. So they have a specific question as to which kind of functions on the set of partitions will lead to some reasonable form of cumulants and stuff like that. I cannot explain what is reasonable, etc. now. But I don't know what is the corresponding convolution and other things there. So there are things which interpolate between classical convolution and free convolution that exists. This is a partial answer to your question.
So another question that I have is there some relation so you've mentioned about Stiglitz transform, and then somewhere you spoke about positive definite sequence. I don't know what positive definite sequence means, but my question is, does this have something to do with the Stiglitz moment problem?
Well, yeah, exactly. It is exactly that. So all I'm saying is these are the moments of some probability measure. That's the condition for it to be moments of a probability.
So what you mean then is that the Hankel matrix you create this way is actually totally non-negative. I mean, all the minors are, yeah.
So if you take the matrix phi of one, phi of a square, and go on like this.
The powers.
Yeah, but it is the same A on this diagonal. This is the Hankel structure Apurva mentioned. So this matrix is positive semidefinite, meaning that any principal submatrix is positive semidefinite. That's the condition here.
In fact, since these are moments, is the measure supported on R or on the positive side? Because if it's on the positive side, then all non-principal minors are also.
No. There need not be positive. No, this is A is only self-adjoint. It can be on both sides.
Aha. So then it's more the hamburger moment problem than the Stiglitz Bichel. So yeah.
The Stiglitz is on zero infinity, right? Yeah, I mean the hamburger one. Yes. So yeah. The hamburger one is the one I mean. So this is there. Yeah.
Vishal might prefer the Stiglitz because then he gets total non-negativity. But at least his advisor would, but at least, yeah. But anyway, this is hamburger. Yeah.
For that, you need that's a slightly different condition. You can characterize, I think. So if A is a positive element, for example, then phi of A to the N will satisfy the Stiglitz moment problem.
Great. Thanks. That's useful.
So in that case, it will be measure will be supported on positive side. Yeah.
Right.
Thank you.
Well, maybe I should ask the natural third question here. Is there a case when you can say the measure is supported on 0-1?
I think it depends. So if these are the most standard situation is where we take this on the, so these are all operators on some Hilbert space, let us say, or some, at least some, you take a C star or something.
It's 1 o'clock.
Let's say our algebra is a subalgebra of bounded operators on some Hilbert space.
Right.
Then this measure will be basically related to the spectral measure, where the spectrum of A is. So, for example, if you take a unitary operator, then the spectrum will be inside the unit circle. Or if you take something which is, you can, between 0 less than equal to A less than equal to 1 in positive definite order here, then it's then the measure will be also on 0, 1. Yes.
Aha, okay.
So, it just depends on the spectrum of that A.
Okay, thanks. That's useful. Thanks.
And one more question, is okay. So you mentioned about, so can you go down? You were mentioning about I'm a bit curious since you have mentioned. So does it have something to do with the longest increasing subsequence problem in permutation?
It very much has. Very briefly, the longest increasing subsequence, the way it was solved was to not just consider the longest increasing subsequence, but the entire shape of the diagram distributed according to Plancherel measure. So if you take partitions of n with probability d lambda squared over n factorial, you pick among all partitions of the integer n, but not uniform probability, but with Plancherel probabilities, which is d lambda squared divided by n. D lambda is the dimension of the corresponding representation. Then the shape of the diagram looks, okay, I'm writing it in this what is called Gaussian coordinates. There is a very specific shape that comes, which is usually denoted omega. After scaling, it converges to a particular shape. And these shapes, these kind of shapes and measures are in one-to-one correspondence. So if you just parameterize in a different way, this shape is exactly what we call semicircle measure. So there is a one-to-one correspondence between shapes and measures. And in that, this measure that arises in the Vershey-Kerov theorem is the semicircle measure. So in that sense, yes. So it has to do with the longest increasing subsequence problem in that sense, yes.
Thank you.
Any more questions? It looks like there are no more questions. I would like to really thank you, Manju, for having the patience to explain this again to us. And you know, you gave this wonderful lectures on random matrix theory and so on earlier, and I hope you know I can impose upon you to give a couple more lectures.
Probably one lecture will finish everything I know,
despite my not having been the ideal student for your earlier course. So I didn't understand and didn't spend enough time, but I'm curious about certain aspects of this. So the interesting, I mean, this non-crossing partition has taken a life on a life of its own in algebraic combinatorics. Maybe Arvind Iyer can throw some light on that. So I'm not sure if those problems are really go back to the origins of this topic in terms of the work of Vaiculescu and Kreveras.
I see. What kind of, I mean, maybe you can you send me something? I don't know what kind of problem. You referred to it in one of your mails that there is this in algebraic combinatorics, yeah. They study this lattice
form. Yeah, sure. I'll send you some links. I don't remember the exact references offhand, but the papers of people like Ardin and Reutemann and so on. So some people in the audience here are probably familiar with those things.
Okay.
Sure. Yeah, so thanks a lot. And I think we can all unmute and give Manju thanks. So with that, I guess we come to an end of